Greetings. How are you doing today? Now, I can't hear you, but does it ever really matter even if I could today? So anyways, I'm going to talk to you about the R8 over here on my side of the pond. You know, the JP Morgan and Rockefeller side of the pond. I'm going to try to do so in a clean manner where, you know, I don't use too much explicit, blotty language. I'm trying to put on my shoes here, trying to put them on. Okay, they're on. Okay, so here we go. What I like about this bloody car, of course, it's a hybrid electric, so you get to plug it in and leave and drive in fully electric mode. Look how easy it was to sit in. It's like nothing. I just slide my little arse on this right here. This oversized carbon fiber door jam. It's bloody beautiful. Close the door like so. Do I have to put keys in? No, of course not. I don't got to put keys in. I just bloody press a button. Do I want all electric? Comfort. Do I have to let go of the parking brake? Of course not. I just bloody go. The bloody iPhone decided to cut you off. Maybe it doesn't like you. Oh no, take it up with them. It's not bloody my fault. So anyways, as I was saying, I'm gonna give you a rundown of the R8 in a way that hopefully doesn't offend too many bloody people. And if it does, well, deal with it, sissy. I don't really give a freak. Okay, maybe I do. But anyways, whatever. I'm not gonna try. Anyways, so the bloody R8. Bloody eight. It's a freaking grand old car. And here's why it is. Okay, I'm only getting 52 miles a gallon. Only 52 miles a gallon. All truth is relative, which means all truth is somehow only true in that form because it's related to a whole bunch of other truths. Like I'm driving right now, or if I was at a stop sign, I'm stopped right now. I'm stopped relative to the world, but to an observer, say, on the sun, I'm spinning at, you know, however fast around it. So like I said, all truth is relative. I'm only getting 52 miles a gallon right now. In the i8, I can get more, but hands down, it is an incredible improvement over my last BMW, which was a 650i. Which, if I played around Florida here and there, I was getting 12.5 miles a gallon. The best I could do with coasting and barely playing around was 18 point something miles a gallon, which really caused some cognitive dissonance inside my mind as to if I wanted to drive it or if I just wanted to drive the smallest vehicle I had at the time, whatever, a motorcycle or a 3 Series. You hear the engine kicked in because right now it's in comfort mode, which differentiates between the front electric motors, and then when it needs extra horsepower, the motor kicks in the gas motor to give you more horsepower. I could switch into e-drive, which is all electric, but anyways, as I was saying, the first thing you can notice is miles per gallon. Wonderful. I've owned a lot of BMWs. None of them I really liked. I thought BMW in general was overrated. This car, however, has made me feel like I like BMWs. And so I'm going to try to tell you why. First off, the car, sorry, window was open. The car is not designed like a regular car, regular steel unibody. It's a carbon fiber body on aluminum frame. So what does that do? That means that, sorry, I saw the popo. I saw the popo, so I lost my train of thought. What it means is it's lighter. This car is coming in a little over 3,000 pounds. Well, that's one of the things it means. What does that mean? It means that you don't have to have a lot of horsepower to make this car go fast like other cars, and that is what helps the fuel efficiency aspect of the car. It's lighter, doesn't need as much horsepower to go as fast, you know. Oh. I hope I didn't flip it around right now. Oh. Holy bloody shit, was it this way or was it this way? I'm gonna go with this way. So anyways, like a motorcycle, you know, you could have 150 horsepower and you're flying around like a freaking Indy car. That's one thing that the carbon fiber body does. And another thing about that is when a car is lighter, all the wear and tear is going to be lessened. You know, where if you have an excessively heavy vehicle, the steel and whatever the components of the car are made out of are going to have different stresses. If the car is lighter, they're going to be compromise less or wear down. You know, it's like if you're sanding something, the harder you press, the more you tear up the substrate that you're sanding. So with a lighter car, you know, with the micro friction that there's going to be even less of it. And so that's another thing, the wear and tear of the car is going to be relatively less. Relatively, meaning if it was a heavier car, it would be more, all else being equal. So that's another thing. Another great thing the carbon fiber body does is keeps the car cool. I can go, you know, go somewhere for a couple hours at 12 or whatever, come out and you expect the car to be hot, but often the car is cooler than the ambient temperature outside. And I've surmised with deductive reasoning that's the carbon fiber shell that is not as heat conducive as steel would be, and helps, you know, keep the car cool by not transferring so much heat energy into the rest of the car, which is just an awesome side effect of BMW's attempts to keep the car light. And another great thing about a light car with electric motors, you know, electric motors don't wear out as fast, don't have as many components that wear out, I should say, as a, you know, traditional gas combustion engine. So, you know, replacing those parts, just the bearings, isn't as a large of a feat. So BMW put a lot of money in the initial design, and the initial price tag reflected that, but you can get a used one. And it, you know, if you know how to look for a deal, you know, I know how to look for a deal. I don't have, you know, the roots of finances that allow me to pay full price. You know, I would love to if I had it like that, but I don't feel I do. So I got a good deal, and you can too. And so you get a great deal on used one of these that has a massive amount of engineering, which is probably going to continue, or possibly, I'm thinking, to reward, you know, absence of any unforeseen design flaw that hasn't been made apparent, reward the owner of the car for years to come. I mean, if they have designed it right, a lot of the parts could be easily replaceable without having to spend large amounts of money. So in that sense, it's an investment. And if you can get one for half price, this one retailed at $154,000, then there's really only double the price of a traditional nice car. And, you know, it's something you can drive around possibly for years, continue to feel great, as opposed to, you know, owning a fucking Camry with leather. Oh, sorry, cussed. So anyways, what's great about this car? I watched a few other reviews, and they're like, several of them are like, oh, you know, if you own this car, you don't care about gas. So, you know, like me, I just keep it in sport mode all the time. It's like, motherfucker, it doesn't matter if you care about gas, about spending money or gas or not. The not using as much gas is much bigger than your own fucking financial interests as to how much you have to put in your tank. The bottom line is climate change is real. Carbon is a much more efficient greenhouse gas than the other gases that have traditionally been in our atmosphere during the existence of human beings. So it's pretty freaking simple to understand that if carbon traps heat energy better, the planet's gonna warm up relative to if we weren't spewing massive amounts of carbon into the air. Global warming is going to happen, whatever to the degree, absence of an unforeseen catastrophe like a nuclear war or an asteroid hitting the planet and creating, you know, some sort of winter. Absence of unforeseen events such as that, global warming is real, we're producing. But even if you don't believe in that, if you're, you know, one of the people that 30 years ago believed that smoking didn't kill people because that's what the moneyed interests told you and that's what the politicians were bought to pretend to believe as well, even if you're one of those people, you really got to be an unthoughtful person if you believe that the wars that have been caused in the Middle East have nothing to do with our dependence on fossil fuel and the world's dependence on fossil fuel. And basically, when you move to an electric car, when you move towards a future instead of the past, into possibly renewable resources instead of dead resources that ironically just create more fucking death. And what do I mean by a dead resource? I mean, well, guess what oil is? It's freaking dead dinosaurs that we're burning and killing people in order to procure, to acquire. So women and children are dying in the Middle East and in South America. You know, you got the IMF, the World Bank doing things to extract the oil there. And, you know, there's all, you know, we got Standing Rock and what those people are going through trying to protect their water. Many people have already been affected by fossil fuels and people have suffered and their lives have been ruined over it. So, motherfucker, it's not about you and your stupid fucking care about if you spend a little bit more at the tank so you're going to put in sport mode. What you're doing is you're fucking squandering BMW's attempt at something better by not even taking advantage of the fact that, yeah, you could pop it into sport, but you can pop it right back into fucking comfort e-drive and be driving a fucking Prius even while you look like you're driving a fucking spaceship. You dumb, stupid bitch. You don't deserve what you have. Sorry, shouldn't be cussing. Sorry. I get upset. People only think about, I mean, just that they have the ability to own these things and there's such ignorance, manifestedly trashy people. Even it, you know, I was there too. I didn't know if global warming was real, so it's nothing against their character. It's, you know, but you would hope that people that got ahead really were better. You know, if it was a true meritocracy, which means people with the most merit get ahead in America, then the people that were smarter and knew more would get ahead. But unfortunately, what's been built, especially since the times of Reagan, is an oligarchy, which, you know, old money gets to thrive and create more money, a bunch of passive income. They don't have to be smart. They don't have to be driven. They just got to be connected. It's really unfortunate. It comes from an atmosphere of basically ignorance and corruption. And ignorance breeds ignorance. And that's what we see, but that's a complete tangent from the car. So back to the car. It is an incredibly beautifully designed vehicle. It does have driver assistance. I haven't witnessed it alerting me of needing to brake. It does not have blind spot assistance, which is very unfortunate. You know, something that the Tesla does have, it shows it right on your instrument panel where that a car might be in your blind spot. Not only that, you know, it has autopilot, so the car freaking drives itself. It has a big screen, you can Google whatever you want, and so for that, this car is not as good. But you take in the whole package, you got a car that looks like a freaking spaceship with butterfly wings. You still have back seats if you have somebody that, you know, you got a baby seat or a small person you can put in the back. It's a car that gets compliments daily. I mean, it's a supercar. And I much rather have this car with a Tesla, it's I only slightly would like to have this car more. The Tesla is a beautiful car, but I much rather have this car over a Lamborghini or Ferrari, you know, some 500 horsepower car that if you play around gets 10 miles a gallon, but you're like, hey, I don't care, you know, I don't care about the gas, and look at me, I look cool, right? I can afford this car, so I'm good. Yeah, I don't care about anything other than myself, but you should like me because I have this really fucking cool car. It's like, dude, I don't want it. I don't want your car. I don't want your ignorance. I don't care if you have a lot of money. See you for what you are, even if you don't see yourself for that. I don't want to be that person. I much rather have this car. And I much rather have cars like this. And I much rather put my money towards vehicles that, you know, still a supercar, still an awesome car, but are willing to compromise here and there in order for the greater good. I feel much better about that. I feel good about that. I don't feel good about a backwards looking car from the past. And for the most part, even BMW has been a car maker of the past, while Tesla is a car maker of the future. So, but with that stated, this car is beautiful. There are some things, like I said, it doesn't have blind spot, doesn't have cooled seats, but seats are incredibly thin, you know, like supercar seats. So I understand that. And again, with the carbon fiber body, you don't need that. And another thing is, okay, so the negatives, people say, oh, well, it's a hybrid. The battery is going to go bad. Yeah. Okay. In 8 or 10 years, the battery is going to be bad. But on the flip side of that, the brakes aren't going to be as bad because you have regenerative braking. The motor is not going to be as bad because it's not used as much. There's other things that aren't. And the positive to replacing the battery is that lithium ion technology continues to advance. Like, you know, once every 6 months, they're finding something to improve the battery. So in 8 or 10 years, when I have to replace this battery, it's going to be a better battery. And so the bridled horsepower in these motors can be released, the range of the car can be increased. So I almost look forward to getting a new battery. Not that I would want that, because it's like $10,000. Not that I would want that right now, but there's very positive things to it. On the other positives, you're not creating that as much brake dust, you know, which has asbestos in it. You're not creating as much many micro pollutants from that happen from the combustion and the catalytic converter, you know, that we breathe and gets lodged in our brain, and we don't even know the long-term consequences of, because researching those things are against, you know, pretty much our society and the moneyed interests therein. So anyways, has a lot of good things. The car is beautiful. The car is very comfortable, very nice to drive, very quiet with the electric motors, very aesthetically appeasing from outside. And I think, you know, cars generally are consumer products. It's a foolish move for the most part to buy a car within 2 years of its production, you know, get a used car. And cars continue to drop in value, most of them. But with this car, I see there's a different dynamic with the electrical aspect of it. I mean, there's a possibility that you could turn this into an all-electric car one day. You know, there's a possibility that the range of these batteries would increase so much that the engine would almost be redundant for simple travel purposes. Again, the expense of creating this carbon fiber body in this light car gives rise to an unusual, not advantage, you have an unusual chance to have a car that simply would last longer than most cars in that price range. That would wear less. And I'm sure carbon fiber, you know, of course it has negative there's negativity attached to carbon fiber. It can bubble and it needs to be resurfaced. You can take that into account or whatever, but really that's all static, in my opinion. Yeah, you got to listen to it, but not a big deal. I'm trying to think of negatives to the car. I think most of the time I'm slamming my BMWs. Slamming them. You know, since I was a little kid, I've seen the degradation of our roads, you know, as they have not been given the funding and the thought necessary in order to create a, you know, efficient, safe transportation system. What this car does is it frees me from a lot of those casual stressors that I, as a thoughtful person, would deal with on a regular basis. So like, you know, the proliferation of stop signs, having to waste the kinetic energy in your car to come to a complete stop, you know, or if you don't, there's going to be some police officer, there's a possibility of a police officer waiting for you to do that. And even though it wasn't unsafe what you did, he's going to write you a ticket for an infraction, while the establishment that, you know, diverted money to places where they could get better kickbacks and stay in power longer, you know, and create things like the drug war, which victimizes millions of people, and wars in other countries where servicemen have died and become maimed over falsified information, as happened under the Bush administration, you know, with yellow cake uranium and fake ties to Saddam and Afghanistan, that he was harboring terrorists, etc., etc. All the money going into that, all the people dying because of that, and yet the police want to, you know, write me a ticket for some minor infraction that didn't endanger anybody, but simply did not obey some arbitrary law that was put in place to basically, you know, keep us under their thumb as they protect, as the police aren't really there to protect freedom or the public. I mean, if you just look at the effects, are there to protect a system that is not working for us, but using us to work for it. So this car frees me from the stress of knowing that because of that system and that waste, when I sit in traffic or come to an unnecessary stop sign or, you know, a protected red light, left-hand turn where there could have been something better, knowing that, or just a red light in general, instead of me knowing that I had to not only waste that kinetic energy by turning it into things like brake dust and heat, instead of doing that, you know, the regenerative braking system of this and many, or maybe all plug-in hybrids, collects that energy, stores it, and allows you to use it, you know, after the stop sign or the traffic that you incurred and had to come to a stop, whatever it was, allows you to use it for acceleration, so you get to bottle that energy. The technology has allowed us to do that. So no longer is stop and go traffic so casually frustrating, not only because I'm wasting time, but just because I'm producing waste. And even though I was pretty good relative to other people that drive on the freeway in minimizing that, having a hybrid with regenerative braking, or even a hybrid, either one helps by doing that, allowing you to save that kinetic energy, not wasting it away into, you know, heat and brake dust as it transforms into some other unusable pollutant. So is the car perfect? No. What is perfect? Nothing. Biggest argument that detractors of this car make is that it's not fast enough, you know, like it should be as fast as every other supercar or faster, whatever the stats say, whatever their ideas are. And really, I don't even know if I should address it, because if I was to address it like they would, it's kind of like arguing with idiots. And from a distance, nobody can tell the difference. So I want to be like, hey, you stupid mother. Anyways, But people that think it's just all about speed are missing the point. They're missing the big picture, everything about this car. That this car is a step into the future and not a continuation of a rapacious, predatorial past. A past of burning, of stealing resources, of stealing people's resources, not only stealing the resources of the American people by a few connected people and then selling them back to us at a profit, resources that came from our ground that our government that is supposed to serve us has allowed a few men to steal, not inventors, just regular dudes that are connected, and then sell back to us at a profit. And then through that influence, also to go into other countries, make up lies and steal their oil. So again, it's a step from that. And people that don't see it, that are only like, oh, well, it's not fast enough. It's a stupid car. They're stupid. It's like in psychology, you call that projection. You know, you're projecting your own negative attributes onto something else. The car is pretty fantastic. It is, as they say, the ultimate driving machine, this car. All the other BMWs, the M's, they're nothing to me. Gas guzzling, whatever. You know, oh wow. Got a big gas guzzling engine. The AMGs, the Z06s, whatever. Nothing. They're a celebration of ignorance, basically. An ignorant past. As cool as, you know, they seem right now, they're not going to in the future. It's a lot of wasted energy, those cars. That's what they do, because you're not racing them every day. And if you're only taking them out to go super fast and you're hardly using it, and are you even getting your worth out of the car? Where this car is completely different. Again, it's super light, and the motor turns off and on, so you're not being apart so much. Of course, the car is going to advance over time. This is like a prototype. Next generation is going to be a lot better. But, you know, it's better than the next. It's better than most cars. It's not a car that inherently wastes energy while maintaining a fun drivability, an awesome drivability. That is the key, you know? That is what separates it from its, what would be its traditional competitors. And if you don't see that, you don't see the bigger picture, that's on you, that's not on me. You know, you can go keep being ignorant and enjoying your soap operas and your Nicki Minaj videos and thinking that, you know, that everything's good, but I don't want to be a part of so much of killing people and promoting our military to go use depleted uranium bullets or whatever in Iraq and Syria. The bottom line is we're polluting the environment. We need to stop it. No organism can be any healthier than the environment from which it came. Like, you don't understand that we're polluting everything. We're destroying everything. And it's not only us as biological organisms, but as social beings. We are polluting the world with genocide, negativity, rapaciousness, you know, people acting like predators. And it's not cool, and it's not powerful. And the thing is, it's the young kids. You know, some of them are badasses, some of them want to be badasses and really aren't, that are doing the fighting. And it's fucking cowards. Excuse me. It's cowards. Establishment cowards. Elite cowards. What I mean by elite, I mean monetarily elite, connected, but they're not elite. They're not superior. they're inferior. They ain't shit, but they have power right now over us in the world. And disconnecting yourself from that is a good thing. But of course, they don't want you to. And as long as you, read the books they tell you to, or watch the shows they give you, watch the news they give you, you're never going to know that. You're going to think like everyone else that does the same thing and be divided against everyone like me. And they win because it's divide and rule. And that's what they get to do. And I know it's not my fault because I know the truth. I got to do what I got to do to wake people up. But I can't do much more than that. Till the majority's woken up, oppression's going to remain. Going to remain a pivotal part. And it's, of course, it isn't manifested oppression. All these goods are easier to acquire, you know. There's been automation. We got China to do our labor super cheap, so we don't realize, you know, so we have all this future junk in our hands. We're like, yeah, well, the world hasn't changed that much, even though we can't really ever own our own homes. Not like you ever did, because you had to pay taxes on them. But, you know, with the feds pumping out money and buying treasuries that are backed by mortgages, I mean, it goes on and on. I'm not going to get into it right now, but, again, man, not a perfect car, but it's leaning towards the good side, so it's going to get good reviews. Please, anyone that watches this, whatever, tell me what you think. Thanks.